All right, so the Mac Mini just got an entire makeover with the upgrade to the M4. It's smaller and it even has a bit more personality to it. But is it really all good news? I've been using this Mac Mini with an M4 Pro chip for a week now. Let's talk about the 7 things you absolutely need to know about Apple's miniature Mac. And first, we have to start with this all new design. Apple made the Mac Mini even more compact. It's now 5 by 5 inches and just 2 inches tall. Super small. If you're looking for a clean desk setup or something that doesn't dominate your workspace, this definitely fits the bill. It's perfect for that minimalist vibe, and visually, it's a win. I know the look matters to a lot of people, and the new Mac Mini looks great. Now, one of the more notable updates in this redesign is the inclusion of front-facing ports. For the first time, Apple has included 2 USB-C ports and a headphone jack on the front, making it much more convenient to plug in peripherals without having to reach around the back every time. This is a small change that makes for a big difference in usability. The headphone jack also adds to the vibe that makes the Mac Mini look like a tiny Mac Studio, as you can see here. The back panel has also been enhanced with versatile connectivity options. You've got 3 Thunderbolt ports, an HDMI port, and a gigabit Ethernet port. Apple also gave the Mac Mini a brand new thermal architecture. Air is guided through different levels of the system, with venting conducted through the base, which helps to keep the device cool under load. While this is great for most scenarios, it does have its limitations. There are fewer vents now overall, which means that if you're pushing the system with heavy-duty workloads non-stop, you might see some thermal throttling kick in. I mean, personally, I haven't even heard the fan spin up at all, not even once, outside of when I was using Cinebench for benchmarking. Speaking of which, let's talk performance. The M4 Pro chip in the unit I've been testing is a beast on paper. 12 CPU cores and 16 GPU cores. Compared to the M3 Pro, the M4 Pro makes a significant shift in how those CPU cores are distributed. The M4 Pro features 8 performance cores and 4 efficiency cores, compared to the M3 Pro's balance of 6 performance cores and 6 efficiency cores. This change means the M4 Pro is geared more towards raw power, ideal for sustained heavy workloads while still keeping some efficiency in play for lighter tasks. You're getting a 1.5 times boost in graphics performance over the M3 Pro, and yeah, in benchmarks, it outshines even some pricier desktops. If you're into creative work, video editing, 3D rendering, simulations, it's all there. But let's talk about real-world use. You have a lot more headroom when working on the M4 Pro compared to the previous M3 Pro. Apple did a great job modernizing this chip, so much so that it even outperforms the M3 Max in a lot of places. With a compact design and limited cooling, thermal throttling can be a real issue. That means that while the Mac Mini can reach those high peaks, it might not sustain them for hours on end without slowing down. So if you're working on those massive projects that need consistent horsepower, just keep that in mind. The memory bandwidth is also worth mentioning, 273 gigabytes per second, which is fantastic for moving big files around, especially if you're into video editing or heavy development work. Thanks to the hardware accelerated ray tracing support, along with mesh shading, you could honestly stick one of these under your TV in your living room and you'd have a powerful media streaming machine that can also hold its own in gaming using a Bluetooth controller. Next up, connectivity. Here on the M4 Pro model, Thunderbolt 5 ports are here with speeds up to 120 gigabits per second. That's a huge jump from Thunderbolt 4's 40 gigabits per second. And if you're connecting external storage, high resolution monitors, or other bandwidth hungry peripherals, it's gonna be a massive difference. But here's a reality check. Most people don't yet have peripherals that can fully take advantage of Thunderbolt 5 just yet. It's all about future proofing right now, so it's ready for whatever comes next, but unless you're set up to really use it, the value won't be immediate. Oh, and let's not forget the power button. The controversy is that Apple moved it to the bottom rear of the Mac Mini. I don't find this to be a big deal at all. There is enough space there for you to just put your finger underneath and press it, but I'm someone who probably presses this button maybe 3 to 4 times per year. So again, no big deal to me. The bigger controversy to me might be the configuration. So let's talk about that. First, there's the standard M4 Mac Mini to consider. It comes with a 10-core CPU and a 10-core GPU. And it's a great option if you're not looking to go all in on power. It starts with 16 gigabytes of RAM and can go up to 24 or 32 gigabytes, which is honestly pretty reasonable if your needs are more basic. Things like casual editing, office work, or coding. But if you're looking at the M4 Pro, you're getting a 12-core CPU and 16-core GPU and 24 gigabytes of RAM, which is a powerful setup. This one's built for people who mean business. Again, video editors, music producers, developers. It's got the specs to handle these intense workflows. But as you start start adding features, that price tag climbs. You can configure up to 8 terabytes of SSD storage, and that's great if you're working with massive files. But the prices on all the storage upgrades are steep. External storage might be a smarter move for most people. It's a cost versus convenience trade-off, but it's worth considering. And let's talk RAM. Starting at 16 or 24 gigabytes is great. Big shout out to Apple for that. But the options go up to 32, 48, or 64 gigabytes, depending on the chip you choose. And if you decide to go there, it does turn into a little powerhouse, but you really need to make sure you're gonna use all that extra memory, because otherwise you're spending big for performance that won't really get tapped into during everyday tasks. Additionally, Apple offers a $100 option for a 10 gigabit Ethernet port on the Mac Mini, which is a nice upgrade if you're using it in a network intensive environment or just need faster data transfer speeds. That's the model I've been using, and as you can see, I'm able to take advantage of that upload speed. But here's something that'll really drive home how steep these upgrade prices are though. If you want to buy an entry level M4 Mac Mini at $599 and decide to upgrade it to 32 gigs of RAM and 512 gigabytes of storage, that Mac will cost you $1,199. That's literally $1 more than the price of just buying two base model Mac Minis, which is crazy because it's the same amount of RAM, 32 gigs versus two 16 gigabyte models, and the same amount of storage, 512 gigs versus two 256 gigabyte models, but you're also getting two M4 chips, two aluminum housings, two whole computers. So while the upgrade options are there, it's just a significant jump in cost that isn't always the best value for what you're getting. Next, if you're the kind of person who loves a multi-monitor setup, you are in luck. The new Mac Mini supports up to 3 6K displays. That is a lot of screen real estate and perfect for creatives who need to juggle different tools and timelines. But here's the catch there. Because the Mac Mini doesn't have a dedicated GPU, pushing all those pixels can lead to increased fan noise or even reduced performance if you're really maxing things out. Then there's the headphone jack up front. Again, Apple upgraded it to support high impedance headphones, which is a plus if you're into high quality audio. But honestly, if you're serious about audio production, you're still gonna want an external DAC or interface. The internal improvements are great, but they're not quite on par with professional gear. Finally, we've got a lot of versatility here. The Mac Mini has always been that flexible, do-it-all kind of device. It fits great in a home office, works well as a media center, or can even be used as your workstation in a studio. And this is what I'll point people to when they ask, why doesn't Apple make a larger iMac? Just grab a Mac Mini and whatever display you want, and you will be good. Its power and small size make it a great fit for all sorts of setups. You can even use it as a server for small businesses or as part of a creative render farm. So those are the things you need to know about the new Mac Mini with M4 Pro in particular. It's powerful, it's compact, it's sustainable as Apple's first carbon neutral Mac, but it's not without a few trade-offs. Smaller design, more power, but potential thermal limits and a steep price for higher configurations. If you're thinking of making the upgrade, just be sure to weigh everything carefully when picking the specific configuration that you want. Thanks for watching as always, guys. I appreciate your support. I'm Andrew Edwards, and I will catch you in the next video.